We are going to talk about the very difficult concept, which is imaverbagination. And that's a term that Mikhail Allenov is going to explain. He is doctor of philosophy, he is an art historian, professor and a researcher, and an expert in the history of Russian art. And I hope that you will enjoy this serious talk about Victor Pivovarov's art tonight. Without any discounts, so to say, or concessions with regard to mass view on Victor Pivovarov. So, imaverbagination is the first altiloquent word in the title of my report, which aligns with the combination of the given included in the phenomenon called conceptualism. So, imaverba is a word produced in the form of image, the way we say it in the graffiti or on posters, sometimes with cut out colorful letters. Then, image is merged with imagination. And the word and the concept of image is essential here. Let's say I show a palm and I say it's a foot. No, you'll say it's a palm. But why do we know? Why do we know just by a pronounced word that it's this and not that? Because the word invokes what we call the image and what the image essentially is from the vast depth of memory. There's no thing, but there is what it represents visually before it is presented and seen with your own eyes. Thus, the image is derived, it comes out from the image and becomes image. The artist creates by action taking himself out, as one of romantic philosophers formulated it. Now let's focus on word concept imagination. If the image retrieves something and puts in the light something that's kept in the memory or idea in a known, complete and ready-made form, imagination merges images that have expectable, easy-to-forecast and well-known forms, but create unexpected, unknown, made-up, often fantasy combinations. Such combinations do not fit into the established and familiar word image. Conceptualism deals exactly with this kind of borderline, transitional collisions and the relations between the common and special situations in visual art. That can be compared with irrational equations. Not to be solved, those equations, but just to try to identify possible ways for solution. That's what matters. Images enclosed in a word are not always visual and are not necessarily visual, even when we use a common word literally. But what do we mean literally? And what does it mean to see the word literally? That is, by letters. Doesn't it mean to step on the way of taking away its meaning, of making it meaningless, especially if the word has multiple meanings, for example, a map or a chart? And in Russian, a picture is its derivative, and then etymologically close word charter. So embedding a word in a series of images as a special aesthetic phenomenon appears in conceptualism. It is quite symptomatic in this regard that Eric Bulatov, so I speak about Moscow conceptualism, that's the name that it had, and basically we speak about the 1960s. So there was the movement of the 60s. So the conceptualists that worked in the 1960s were main three artists, Bulatov, Kabakov, and Pivovarov. I would say they were the great trinity among the conceptualists. So, you know, Kabakov, this name can be traced down to the word kabak, which is a restaurant, and Pivovarov, which is a beer brewery. And so it's quite symptomatic that Eric Bulatov had his personal exhibition on the 8th of October 2003 for his 70th birthday, the Tretiakov Gallery, when he read his new essay, Picture with Text. And another example is the only piece of the most famous artist of postmodernist time, Ilya Kabakov, that made its way to the Tretiakov Gallery of Contemporary Art. It's The Answers of Experimental Group, which has only letters, only text. And finally, Victor Pivovarov's book that came on time for the opening of his personal exhibition at the same place in March 2004. It is called About Love Between Word and Image. So the image whose foretype is a written letter, so this is all about metamorphosis related to signs. Because that's what conceptualists are interested in. But that's a separate topic. So, anyway, the image whose full type is a written letter, word, suggests a plane perpendicular to the eye line. That is a closing perspective, a depth of special temporal extension. This plane has many variations: a wall, a door, gate, a stand, a shield, a bill, a poster, a curtain, a screen, a school board, a book page, an album sheet, cover, wrap, table, chart, map, glass window, a screen, etc. So these are all planes that give us some information that we can read. But in order to perform a function of sign production, this plane should not know about its specific reincarnations in kind. It's like in order to read something written, let's say, on glass, we should distance ourselves from its object qualities, that is, the ability to reflect what's in front of it and make visible what's behind it. In this detachment, it is a thing which is not phenomenal, not given us in senses. That is merely nominal image of the boundary between here and there. So conceptualists, including Pivovarov, said that the prime moment in visual art was a stand or a board to them. So the poetics of a stand or the poetics of the board, what is it? It's a plane with something written on it. But we can't see what's there. It's just the boundary between here and there. So this boundary has certain properties. It can be, it can have some rough surface. It can have a certain color, whereas a poster can be put on a different board with a different color. So this abstraction of this border is of interest for. In the phenomenal realm, the image and the likeness of this noumenon are located between two poles, a strophic unit for letters on one pole and just an empty page on the other pole. It carries them, it holds them, it lets them be read literally as letters that constitute words. The sequence of superimposing coloring materials, which is able to leave a visible trail on a certain surface to assure that we see things, people, sky, clouds, depth of perspective, this sequence makes the surface somewhat transparent, invisible, non-existent. So we see what's drawn on it, but we don't perceive the plane itself. So depicted in such a way, objects display or manifest the properties of sign. That's what Pivovarov established a while ago. Direct, honest, demonstrative, that is a naturalistic embodiment of this paradox. Not to forget Pushkin's famous statement, the genius, the friend of paradoxes, is a painted plane, a mask hiding the painting, concealing the painting that we'll never know about what was depicted on it, while knowing that the painting is depicted or was depicted or will be depicted on the same plane of the same canvas. This plane is no more than the back side of canvas, the canvas from the side of the stretcher. However, for us to see it as the wrong side of painting canvas, it should be shown as a lining, a fabric that can be used as upholstery for some other plane, having, just like a stretcher or a frame, an elevated relief, some doodling by a scribbler could be on that plane with anything pinned to it. This obviously requires some skill, the art to materialize this situation, to portray and bring it to mimetic particularities, optical illusions in the image on the canvas that has the same backside and a frame. That's how it works in Pivovarov's cycle Time of Rose. This image of a plane, which is a barrier or an obstacle, in Pivovarov's works unfolds nearly the entire spectrum of refractions, all generating meanings. On one pole, there are scrolls with the letters of pseudo-hieroglyphs. By the way, the main principle of hieroglyphic writing, a drawn letter read as a decorative ligature on the plane before and irrespective of whether you know the meaning of the sign, is demonstrated here with a soft sense of humor with regards to our ability and desire to retrain into new champollions. The decorated plane of paper has a self-sufficient visual value, irrespectively of whether we guess or not, to discern a rose in these writings, or a shadow on the window, or even artist's signature and a title, Chinese lessons in the form of stamps in the oval pictograms. So you can read a shadow on the window, a rose in the garden. On the same pole, there are scrolls with texts that describe, for example, the bustle of city and murmurs of woods, and therein, like many tekel parsin, it's empty around. What is it all for? Come through literally between the lines. By the way, this means, why are there all these writings that should have disappeared for their needless? Along with that, there rise eternal lamenting based on Ecclesiastes. That which has been is that which will be, and that which has been done is that which will be done, so there's nothing new under the sun. All is vanity and vexation of spirit. Thus the writings will disappear, and so what? Just a blank sheet will remain. So this is the other pole. Let's take the concluding album Yellow, a blank sheet. The very same that figures in the phrase, turn over a new leaf. However, it is shown here at the end. Page by page, with painterly mise-en-scene and verbal lead, telling a story of someone somewhere here nicknamed Yellow. In this narrative cycle, the final visual image of the blank sheet acts as a personification of extraverbal being. So, the final visual image of the blank sheet acts as a personification of extraverbal being, muteness. Yet this muteness has a pictorial, coloristic equivalent supported by verbal comment. Only the leaves became more and more yellow. Our imagination sees this vacant, unfilled surface as indefinitely stretched temporal duration, where it picks up intense yellow. So if uncertainty equals infinity, then this yellowness will be the same as the image of eternity. Simply speaking, in the long view, it's turning into icon painting, golden background. Taking its origin from eternity, where everything drowses in nothing, this yellowness has also a different version.
So,
this yellowness has also a different version, which is directly related not to the image of icon painting, golden background, but to a hidden prime metal of iconic painting. It's the color of egg yolk. Here we find ourselves amid inconspicuousness and deserted land, where everything begins with a blank sheet, again and again, or above, from the egg, just like in Russia, everything starts with the egg.
С чистого листа или об ово от яйца, подобно тому, как у нас на Руси, все начинается тоже с яйца, в смысле с корочки ряба.
Or, the hen, ряба. Isn't that the entire theater of the absurd in this egg? What is this fairy tale really about? What's the meaning of things that happened there? Maybe somebody can explain it to me here?
Очень многих.
I've tried to ask many people what Ryaba the hen means, what kind of meaning does this fairy tale have. So maybe Pivovarov knows this. His graphic image tale about yellow begins with a depiction of the image or the ideogram of egg. And later on, everything is moving to an end, which is in effect to the beginning, to a blank sheet, building up strictly randomly inside the cyclic trajectory. This amazing formula of the absurdist catharsis from Alice in Wonderland, translated by Boris Zahoder, expresses the logic of image-word intrigue as precisely as possible, from the egg to a blank sheet in the mentioned Pivovarinny album. And actually, a fairy tale about Ryaba the hen, as assigned image, sort of drawn by mouse tail, the hieroglyph of inexplicability figures incidentally in one of autobiographic fragments in Pivovarov's work. Another starting point is an apple that marks the beginning of history of humankind. There's a sort of apples, белый налив, white transparent, and the one turned by demon into one of the kind weapon of evil misdeed. It's from the kingdom of shadows and is black, of course, but its blackness is of supersensory nature, just like shadow is the image of thing, but not the thing itself. Indeed, the fruit destined to mark the beginning of the way out of paradise is a sign in the ideational space of all human memory, post factum matched to a familiar to all figure named apple. Just like this, condensed, intangible, apple-like darkness, as if made out of soot, and this is a competence pertaining to the art of painting. That's the case with a black apple picture from the Seven Conversations series, something that the Goncourt brothers called the humor of melancholy in their diary. This metaphysic tall tale, a black apple, is joined with two cherries of quite cherry color, similar to key signature in music, turned to a certain tone. This kind of visualization of notional substances is tuning visual attention in to remember notional figures of iconography. What is it below? Leaning to the outline of apple like a shadow. The shadow that the apple resembles here cannot throw a shadow, but the signs and omens cast shadows of things to come. That's how it is. Under the apple, pretending to be a shadow, there is a human being hunkered down, either Adam or Abel, looking like a baby in a womb, or the desperate figure in the Last Judgment in the Sistine Chapel, knocked over to the side. Once again, the beginning thrown back to the end. And in those places where barely noticeable shadow from the stem and apple could really appear if this was a flat silhouette painted black and cut out of paper, put to the flat background, almost merging with it. This shadow from shadow there, minus times a minus equal to a plus, is treated as anti-darkness, flashes, breakthroughs into celestial blue, a constantly recurring motif in Pivovarov's iconography. And now, although more striking as it's barely discernible, behind the plane with the apple, a vision of paradise is looming, eternal there, behind a fence plane, as if there appeared a tiny little cut, like a narrow crack in the gate, whence the ghost of apple wormed through, came out and joined in. Thanks to this almost invisible, yet present, anti-shadow, we have a chance to look into the glowing, heavenly depths, like abundant, literally otherworldly expanse. As mentioned earlier, a drawn letter signifies, irrespective of what it means, the presence of pre-painterly surface, as well as pre-literal, pre-verbal existence, before the letters and words, that is, silence, emptiness. Like Silentium, lying ahead of writing, the plane is an embodied paradox, in particular the image of imagelessness. You know, Tutchev wrote a poem about Silentium, and Mandelstam also had a beautiful poem about Silentium. So why did they use this Latin word, silentium in Latin, means silence or wordlessness, when the word goes down, and also quietness, something that was before the word. So that's the idea. In relation to visual signs of flowing reality, it acts like a dressing screen, blocking there from here. Pauses became longer and longer. Spatial length of unfilled plane with some parts of interior on the left and right is a basic legible metaphoric signifier of temporal longitude, a continuing pause in the album steps of the mechanic. Expanding this duration, ousts narrow fragments of the interior captured by the faceted side, pushing them out to the edges where the objects are tumbling about, falling over, somersaulting and flying. An accurate visual equivalent of noise, hustle and bustle, mess and confusion occurring behind the curtain, on the periphery, beyond the reach of the visible, so that the emptiness of unfilled sheet is perceived like the kingdom of quietness, produced clearly in front of your eyes that brings blissful tranquility. It reminds of a genius animated film by Fyodor Hitruk, The Story of One Crime, that has shots playing a similar role with very brief pauses of quietness without any images. Wordlessness in the image of a blank sheet can be called a visual metaphor of silence. Or silencium. The paradox here is that this image is produced by nature itself, the very nature whose imitation or mimesis from time immemorial, or at least since the Renaissance, has been considered the fundamental principle of visual art. Consequently, a black sheet as the embodiment of silence or silentium is an absolute model of mimetic art. This kind of absoluteness or precision in art, the precision of reproducing observed situations and this skill to imbue a fantasy situations created with credibility as if trained by mimetic experience makes Pivovarov stand out among his conceptualist colleagues. Seemingly a mere nothing like perfect precision that was in seeing and rendering the gas flame, the color, the intensity of pressure under the cooking pot and its shimmering under the frying pan, as well as porous roughness of sizzling scrambled eggs in the pan. The picture is called Яичница, Moscow way of pronunciation, the letter Sh, not Ч, in the title of this piece of art. The handles on the front panel to light the burners are all turned in the same way, even though only two are burning with flame. Is this a trick? Then it becomes clear why the handle on the oven lid looks like a smile. By the way, making faces from still life compositions full of expression is something Pivovarov does brilliantly. For example, this picture from a teenager's diary, or head with a pipe. But if the main authority in this sphere, Archimboldo, always had astonishingly sophisticated algebraic equations, Pivovarov created tableau vivant, that is, living pictures, à la nature. For example, this work, I'm waiting for you, but you are not coming, from the album Cast of Characters. Art mimesis, or painting à la nature, according to Veneziano, from time to time, but inevitably brings to the borderline where something meets nothing, presenting empty canvas and generally framed emptiness as the image of this nothingness, or embodied paradox as the presence of absence. By the way, this is one of migrating stories in the poetry of the absurd and overall the poetics of nonsense. Brought to life in diverse kinds of inconspicuousness. For example, the smile of Cheshire Cat in Lewis Carroll's books, the absence of any presence in Phenomenal Existence, number 2 by Harms, or the poem Do Not Know Who in the book of poems by Genrikh Sapgir in the book Red Balloon. It was illustrated by Pivovarov with an empty frame and a note. Here everybody can draw I do not know who. As an absolute masterpiece portraying the absence of any presence, I would mark a picture from the series Flat 22. You can find it here at the exhibition. A sort of freeze frame with subtitles. Moscow is on air. Moscow time is 7:30 p.m. We're about to begin a program, theater by the microphone. If we only could get back to the 1960s, this was very popular program that many people loved it. They read poems that were so well known. So that's how that program started, the theater by the microphone. This is an ideal situation of abandoning everything that is visible in the invisible, that is, in the images on bodiless plane, not phenomenal, not given us in senses. For the one who becomes imprinted with that freeze frame is no longer here, will be totally gone to plunge into airwaves. Faceless look on the portrait above the table on the left, and everything depicted will turn into a sign, the evidence of reprojection in a different dimension, different from that occupied by the one who saw and captured it. Planimetric statics of simple and clearly readable lines sealed in each other, with glowing surfaces of various intensity being imprinted, turned the image into a design drawing of stained glass window on the subject of Faustin Lingenau with me. The alternative option would be that very mimesis or the illusion of truth inherent to our visual experience in one of the kind idea, like a long, long arm. The silhouette of the arm is getting longer and stretching in the same manner as evening shadows. The house begins to tremble, turning into something like a tent. Here again, the effect of wavering and undulating shadows. And on the sleeve of this hand, we see a tiny ant hurrying home, followed by the dog, also in a rush with his tail up, tugged at the leash in his master's hand, the doggy paddling his paws as if having seen the ant, began to imitate the ant's trot. Once the sun sets down, everybody's running home. The arms waving silhouette is stretching out like a ribbon, a wavy trail path the route, a little bit to the right. A white horse put in the cart, clatter along at a curve in the road. The path is going slowly up the hill, and there on the top, where the path makes a twist, the traveler turns back and rooted to the spot, as if having understood that he had been lost, his feet are fixed together, one hand in the pocket, the other one is hanging down. The sunset sky above the valley in the frame of the window. The night behind the back of a sitting figure. The night here is the same as in the phrase, behind my back, equivalent to waiting in the wings. The night sky above the valley is sunken into a diamond-shaped hole. They are taken as seen in the foreshortening view. The night is hiding far away. Crossing the sunset, reflected in the window frame, the arm is stretched up to a point where the wrist is hanging, emerged from the sleeve with its fingers. It's holding a small house with trees suspended up in the air. On the back of the hand, weightless from the way the palm is bent and the little finger slightly up, light like a toy on the Christmas tree, fragile glass ball with a dawn sky above the valley inside it. Thus, spatial hieroglyphs of temporal longitude spread out broadwise in the plain layout. And then the faltering building leaning to the ground is the chamber of day, but only in the moment that is described as growing towards night. So this daily creature, mind you, with a tie, will have to maintain the balance in the shifting world, following Kozma Prudkov's precept, be aware. Or to rephrase Hamlet's words, the readiness is all. To extend as much as possible the time from dusk to dawn, bypassing the night, leaving it behind. No matter how strange it may seem, but if we try to see the story captured here, it will be quite close, as if the illustration, to the second song of Dante's Inferno in Divine Comedy. Day was departing, and the embrowned air released the animals that are on earth from their fatigues, and I, the only one, made myself ready to sustain the war, both of the way and likewise of the woe, which memory that errs not shall retrace. It may be interesting that Thomas Mann's Dr. Faustus starts with this very verse as an epigraph. Using the ability of shadow to stretch and slide, overcoming boundaries, unaware of the laws of gravity. So why not bypass the bounds of time, making them indistinct? First of all, this figure endowed the hand with this ability, since the hand can stretch forth and forward, extending to the utmost, beyond any reasonable point. But once it has lengthened, gravitational force come into play. And in order to recover the disturbed balance quite naturally by itself, according to the rule of correlation and following the same principle of extending shadow, the leg began to stretch. This adherence to the normal state of things with seemingly absurdity of the premise is probably most fascinating in this piece. Abnormally extended leg is instinctively clear and normal response to the abnormally eccentric trick of stretched arm. And here's the cream of the trick, or hocus pocus. Usually the hand is put out to take or grab something, or to point at something. There is more or less hidden aggression in this reach out. While here, the hand is extended to show completely opposite. Such a precise and ideal hang up of the hand, devoid of any volition, holding effortlessly the house and the whole world, a sort of absolute formula for the balance between your home and spheroidal infinity, reminding of the palm of the Supreme that's holding everything. And it's visibly demonstrated by the fact that it's holding an exoteric sign of microcosm below, a house, and above it holds a macrocosm, correlative with the aides of the house in the articulate metaphoric synonymy, word equals light. World equals light, and light is born out of night in the daybreak sky. And here comes a moment for the piece that came out of the artist's head and hands to make a quite important provision. If this is the palm of the Supreme, with the right hand being a sword arm, so it might well be that it is the hand of the Almighty, and why not? But to announce something like this does not feel the right thing to do, but not because the creature on the picture is wearing a tie. It would just sound like a caricature. It is impossible to say this because it would sound too pretentious and fleshy, as if it were on the ideological poster, whereas Pivovarov's style and form of art statement is alien to any hint at pathos. And that's what makes him different from Bulatov. I think that Pivovarov's artistic mentality has innate idiosyncrasy about any pathos. Kuzma Prutkov has a poem about pathos. And it's actually the synonym of vulgarity in his work. Pathos equals vulgarity. So significant absence is the term used in semiotics, close to conceptualism, with regards to chronology and methodology of working with the text. And quite symptomatic of this is the way the artist acknowledges his feeling of Prague, where his destiny brought him. I felt Prague had a zero energy, having no change whatsoever, neither metropolis nor a province, neither good nor bad, neither active nor passive. I like that. This discharged field, its neutrality and quietness was fine with me. So apparently a clownish scene with a long, long arm turned out to be the apotheosis of mimesis in the image of divine sword arm. Beautiful nature served well the hand of the magician, who demonstrated his main magic trick, holding the balance between a cube, a house, and a ball, the whole world. But the trick is nothing but the name for the most sublime out there in the world, devoid of any pathos, created with a sense of humor. That is a miracle. Either a trick of the eye or a miracle, but the way the hand is shown, maintaining the balance between the heavenly and earthly, a gesture of the right wrist coming out from the sleeve of the left hand, the plasticity of the gesture is striking. It fills me with quite amazement. Along the line of the sleeve, a pedestrian, a dog, and an ant are hurrying backwards. They're shown moving on the upper edge, so they have to balance and maintain ground on the edge, like circus acrobats refraining from falling down to the side. The ant, the dog, the man may not shame the craft skill of the artist who calculated the trajectory path of movement and endowed them with art of maintaining equilibrium on this line, so that they could be recognized just by their silhouettes, gait and posture, and looked like themselves from head to heel. This engineering skill to calculate the required balance for the posture requires sensitivity on the part of the artist, who brings to the viewer's attention a particular manner of every creature to move their limbs, both legs and paws, with the right speed. It has long been known that the genius of man is measured by the degree of attentiveness. That's what Stepan Shevirev said. So, touchingly portraying all the acts and characters in this little theater, true to life, with subtlety and accurate resemblance of their doubles, is based on mature knowledge of the laws of painting architectonics, or the knowledge of something that can be called the rules of painterly syntax. Form is the essential content of plasticity. And it's very similar to, for example, saying is a very long road that waves like a ribbon, and here you can see that he makes a trick out of this metaphor. Look, here's a ribbon, and it's twisting and turning, and now you see it's not a ribbon, it's a road, and here's an arm. the wavy folds of the sleeve, wavy. Maybe it's not the arm, but the river, that's the arm, but maybe it's the arm of the river, because river also has arms. The arm and trouser leg, similar to the arm of the river, are cut out here and red, like they're usually red on the map. The cartographic principle of sewing pattern and adjustment of object forms, and more generally, the map as a kind of plane where the visible reveals the properties of sign is a quite significant precedent in Pivovarov's imagery experiments. A definite masterpiece in this kind, picture the choice, Vibor, from the series Seven Conversations. It makes sense to remind that the map and the picture are related etymologically in Russian and are akin to each other in essence, especially if we take some common word combination, such as the picture of the world, the picture of the universe, where the picture is the image of the whole that is a priori assumed to be infinite. For example, a picture of the starry sky given by a celestial map in a wide view, or the contrary, against the sky on the earth, and in particular the definition for the word map given by Vladimir Dal at the beginning of his list of definitions. A flat sea map, a nautical chart drawn as if the surface of the earth were a plane. Bearing this in mind, we have to admit that the view of the plane covered by panes in a certain order on the above-mentioned picture, Vibor, or choice, from the series Seven Conversations, leaves no choice, without doubt. It is the absolutely identical image of a sea map from Lewis Carroll's The Hunting of the Snark. Have you read it? What's the good of Mercator's North Poles and Equators, tropics, zones, and meridian lines? So the bellman would cry, and the crew would reply, they're merely conventional signs. Other maps are such shapes with their islands and capes, but we've got our brave captain to thank. So the crew would protest that he's bought us the best, a perfect and absolute blank. The white and black circles in the center, due to optical bifurcation, begin to move unpredictably while your eyes are trying to focus on them. They float on and above the surface. You know, it's an optical effect, an optical illusion. When the objects begin to float on and above the surface, together with cabin boxes in the corners, slipping away from being captured in a steel shape. This is the exact visual analogy of virtual existence, of no one knows what, under the name of Snark. We presume that he is white, in a sense goody-goody, that can turn out to be Bujum. We presume that he is black, because he's also like the snark, no one knows what. In short, it's a map for ages-old activity. Go there, no one knows where. Fetch me, no one knows I want. Yet there's a cabin. You feel like asking, what is there in the corner, in the bottom left corner? There's something dark coming out of it right in the center. Who can tell me? What is it? Come on, friends. Have you not listened to Boris Godunov, the opera? What is it, Mama? So, right in the center, there's something dark coming out of it. Since Pivovarov trains his viewers to notice cool little things, he can see that something sticking out from the cabin is nothing else but a human figure, often found in Pivovarov iconography, head and shoulders, as if we see a man standing on the platform from the back. Well, if everything's adrift in the state of such contemplative meditation, then why not see it upside down? The way it happened with the reproduction of this picture in the catalogue of the exhibition Steps of the Mechanic in 2004, where it was reproduced upside down. Therefore, the figure is perceived like a hanging bell tongue that makes this cabin look like a square bell. It seems that the dominance of this map of some space in the unknown latitude and longitude, looking like the windless calm sea that reflects evenly a glimmering sky in the same windless state, and this dumbness is about to ring with the sound of that bell. So there's a man and a bell. In a word, bellman. That's how Carroll called the chief of snark hunting expedition. When he went out into the sea, he presented a great piece of visual art to his crew. He had bought a large map representing the sea without the least vestige of land, and the crew were much pleased when they found it to be a map they could all understand. Given traditional mimesis or the nature, then it is put in the state of anabiosis in avant-garde laboratories. Pivovarov, in Pivovarov's work, this creature is a forbearer, genius, and angel guardian of new European imagery called mimesis, comes back to life, remembering the forgotten, taking time to observe the equipment and instruments of different laboratories with the natural mimetic wit. Beginning with the most important iconic works, full of pathos, and the black square coming in the first place, and then red square. So what? Mere canvases that include different colors, that is, flags. Because black square and red square turned into flags later on. I mean the Malevich's exhibition in 1915. So now the black and white squares have waved a bit, suggesting that in reality they were colorful figures on the canvases that do not mind flying like flags, in other words, gain pathetic idol-making power. Pivovarov at once moves them away like curtains. Behind them, a deserted land of life and a familiar, lonely figure standing with its back to these colors, walking in a reverie behind the black square, like behind the curtains, where a piece of the lay table is opened up on the other side. Such hobnob play with glorious, iconic symbols of abstract art suggests a grasp of its main premise, and in particular, the point formulated mathematically by Vrubel that I mentioned already, saying that form is the ultimate content of plastic art. This is quite possible because pre-visual, seemingly purely formal characteristics of visual field or painterly architectonic center, periphery, top, bottom, right, left, ascending diagonal, descending diagonal, are semantically meaningful. They can be compared with grammatic forms in the language that produce meanings irrespective of specific sounds. For example, a verse from Alice in Wonderland. It was prillic and slithy toves did giant gimbal in a vape. All mimsy were borogoves and the momrats outgrape. These grammar rules, in their turn, become instrumental in mimetic drama when they are tested to the limit of their rightness. This happens when they are off the hook and let float freely, that is, begin to sway, pull off the stable and regular course, begin to be naughty from the adult's point of view. That's how it is in the field of children's literature and children's books. Not least because spatial shifts, crossover of different levels of being, the relativity of habitual and correct system of coordinates often shape the storyline of these books that are very many, from Pogorelsky's Black Hand, illustrated by Pivovarov, or the Thumbelina or Oli Lukoye by Anderson, to Alice in Wonderland and Alice Through the Looking Glass, and further on to The Lord of the Rings, Harry Potter, etc. The very structure of these stories enables the text to float freely with respect to the image and images with respect to each other. So that inside this picture of the world, it is still a question, who illustrates who and who commands who? The word commands the image or the image commands the word? Again, this has always been known. However, it's not always that the poetry of nonsense comes out of here. All the more, it's not always that the artist sees here not only a suitable field for applying avant-garde inventions or an escape from official and ideologized art. For Pivovarov, it happened to be a field for improving mimetic art. Once you see a little bird, a tit, chirping and yelling in the top corner of the page. Taking over the role of a phone ring that fell silent, next to the picture where you can clearly hear how female elk with a male elk walk to water, or a flying swallow in the illustration for the Thumbelina, or a squirrel freezing a jump from tree to tree in the book Big and Small, written by Pivovarov himself. Whereas all these images are not a must. With their attention to detail and accurate memory in recreation of the observed, they surpass any illustrative need. There are two means to awaken and rehabilitate the mimetic element of art in post-avant-garde space. The first one is traveling to the world of childhood, animating inside yourself the state when all the impressions of being were new to us, including impressions from art, both traditional avant-garde, including the texts of those children's books that, of course, were opened again once the illustrations were created. And the second means is humor. Certainly, these means are mutually mediated and not effective without each other. To read only children's books, to cherish only children's thoughts, to dispel all the big things far away, to rise from deep sorrow, to dispel all the big things far away. It is neither a denial nor an overthrow, but avoidance of all the pathos. This is an essential condition of returning to normal proportions of empathic observation and consequently humor. Mind you, not irony or sarcasm, not wit or grotesque, but humor. And here's a sort of children's Freudism. A psychoanalytic look into the subconscious. So, 1960s was the time when people began to discuss Freudism. So, peer into the subconscious, meaning to penetrate into something behind the forehead. Let's get transparent. When it naturally blows your mind like the top of the can, let's see now what's inside. Speaking about psychoanalytic techniques to tap into the subconscious, it is a must to make clear, that is to make the covering shell penetrable or transparent, so that to see with your own eyes what a person remembers unconsciously, instinctively, what melodies he is singing to himself. They appear to be familiar motifs of Pivovarov's iconography. We shall now carefully close the can, that is the remove top of the brain case. There remains a small scar, transparent and hardly noticeable. But that was a monument to one laboratory experiment. Here we have a whole ensemble of figures, but they are bodiless figures, since their glasswork is remarkably intangible. I would call the series transparent, rather than made of glass, стеклянные. So it's a collection of not operational, but transparent souls, a sort of anti-columbarium. An abode with no death, because life hasn't started yet, just like Stepan Verkhovensky, chorus of souls that haven't lived yet, but would like to live very much, at least to see Pivovarov's works and make them part of your inner self, sometimes upside down, sounds like an allegory with a shade of higher humor. This is what Dostoevsky wrote about Stepan Verkhovensky's book. Illustrating books, mainly children's books, is commonplace for the life stories of all conceptual artists. Pivovarov has reciprocity and wisdom coming with experience. And his taking communion with childhood experience determines his unique intonation, the character of highlights, and iconography of recurring cross-cutting motifs. Outerly unexpected, innerly invariable, the motif of loneliness is the main of all. I take part in gloomy life when everybody from one to another is lonely. These motives and mood do not necessarily illustrate famous texts, and it's not by chance that they invoke these very images and associations and not the others. For example, early lyrics of Mandelstam, O Khodasevich, series Mice. All affections and anxiety you forget and keep inside. Pray to you, my little gods, kind to guardians of mine. Take my humble gifts, my dears, piece of cheese, some crumbs of bread. There are no worries, no troubles, no fears. Happiness like pin comes to my heart. You could think that the holiday of overcoming fears and doubts has a direct allusion to this poem by Khodasevich. The supporting text refers to Pivovarov's piece that probably has the biggest of pathos, both in terms of scale and expression, which is Sutra of Fears and Doubts, as if to discredit this very pathos by intimacy and humor of this album miniature. Perhaps the main example of marked anti-pathos a way to produce one of the most popular, sanctified by cultural memory, hence pathetic motives of Russian art present in Pivovarov's compositions in a strictly interior and intimate format, in the form of picture, as if transferred from the reflection on the window. This motive is a twist of road going beyond the horizon on the desert plain under the twilight sky, reminding you of Pasternak's lines about the role, whereby the aim, wherever be it, is living. If it rains or shines, the way far distances look vivid from passing roadways, broken lines. The other angle of this motif, emerging with constant refrain in most unexpected contexts, following the principle omnia meo mecum portu, is a motif of loneliness. And this can be illustrated by Mandelstam's lines, the light cross of lonely walks I will bear humbly again, yet the cross. It is directly related to the sheet evening. It's time to go home from the album Slozy, Tears, a side that encouraged to remember the state of being lost on the level of conditioned reflex in which the gone astray self confronts the lost self. This is it.
Сейчас работа уже 15-го года, 14-го, 13-го, тоже Пивоварова, они очень сильно отличаются.
I'd love to ask you about the works that Pivovarov did in recent years, in 2013, 2015, that cannot be really called conceptualist works. Or do you think there is some degree of conceptualism that perhaps I failed to see?
Вот, значит, во-первых, все-таки да, вот, может быть, что-то Пивоваров тут вот сам.
Well, first of all, Pivovarov might have explained something himself in these little guides for the exhibitions. And I focused in my lecture on conceptualism. I had to talk about the sources, the roots, where this artist came from, what kind of picture of the world he had in his imagination, that has a certain possibility inside for any kind of metamorphosis. And while I was preparing this talk, I thought that some reciprocal steps referring to the 60s and 70s could show precedents of what we are having now. For example, he has this long text, so it's true, it's a trail of the snail. Actually, it's not here, but if you try to remember this text, if you have seen the exhibition, if you take a closer look to it, you will see that it's a very recent invention, and it's exactly the trail of snail. It's a story of a lonely person. It's a real confession of the lonely person. So, the second point that you said, that there were some drawings on this exhibition, like design drawings. But that's the question that we could relate to the album Yellow, with that blank sheet. So what is it as an image, as a visual art? Everything starts with a blank page. And then we see that one of such precedents, where he works with optical bifurcations, some optical equations. I was worrying you would ask me what is conceptualism. So he worked with equations. Do you remember that sea? And they are all schematic So the maps or the charts, he uses cartographic principle of filling in the gaps or filling in that blank sheet. So I guess the questions is so important here. Like we look at all these works and we wonder, what does it have to have to do with art? Why does it why does he use this and that? Why does he do this and that? But he remains faithful in his works. It's not really my field of expertise, but if we begin to think what makes him start modeling and using those drawings, why does he model different geometric images? I guess that's the way he works with space. What is an empty piece of paper? What is a blank sheet? Just like I said, pause, and pauses became longer and longer. So it's like acoustics, an acoustic environment when different things removed further from each other.
Если иметь в виду, что существование слова постулирует существование образа, ну это с чего я начинал. Мандельштам говорил, что слово и образ единосущие.
Мандельштам said that the word and image have the same essence, that word is an image. And the language witnesses imageless entities. And that's what Alcuin referred to when he reasoned with the word nothing, when the word is there, whereas the thing that it represents is not there. And we are sometimes using something which does not exist. So this word nothing, the word is there, but what it signifies is not, yet the same language poses the presence of entities derived from nothing that refer to all that is negligible. Something on the border with nothing is attained on the border. Conceptualist imagery marks it with its emptiness discourse, and that's what conceptual art does. You know, take a look at any kind of actions, there'll be lots of empty spaces, and conceptualism introduced avant-garde non-figuration in the images a la nature. And that's what Pivovarov shows us in his latest works. That's just what I suspect, because I haven't really asked him about it. It's just I wanted to show you that he resonated a lot with different poetic images. He could derive lots of ideas from literature. And if we ask what is literal and illustration, what is it? as a phenomenon. It's not easy to reply. Like I said, most of them were working with books, and it was not quite clear who illustrated who. The text illustrated the images, or the images illustrated the text. So this mutual transformation of the entities. Mattered a lot. And conceptualism as the phenomenon of the 1960s had an impulse towards what's happening at the moment in visual art. It's no longer fine art, it's always visual art. Do you agree with the thesis made by Yuri Albert, who said that conceptualism is the most understandable art, the art that is easiest to understand? Well, it would be good to ask this, to ask Albert this question, because it's interesting to see what he means under conceptualism. What is conceptualism? What an illustration? What is literal with regards to the word and the writing of the word? If you saw Eric Bulatov's exhibitions, you have probably noticed these images, you know, the clouds floating, and the words floating along with the clouds. So, what is a concept? What is a word or an image? What is it? What is conceptualism? So, concept. So we have this in combination, co-resonance. So conceptual means some kind of correlation. So, a certain correlation to some processes that take place in the brain while referring to our visual experience. There is a very good article. You can find it on the internet. You will just type in conceptualism, and you'll see an article by Teimur Daimi, which is called Conceptualism. And he shows where all these crazy things come out that conceptualism deals with. And so he quotes Heidegger. So I come to the university lecture room and I see a lecturing podium. What do I see? Brown surfaces that intersect at a right angle. No, I see something else, a box which is quite big and with another one, a smaller one on top of it. No, again, I don't see that. I see a lecturing podium for a speaker, whereas you are seeing a platform with some person who is going to address to you. So there is nothing that I first see the brown surface, and then they appeared to, before me as a box, and then as a lectern, and then as an academic podium. So it's some kind of our perception. For example, this is a microphone. Then I can see pieces of paper, my glasses. I can see the people in the audience. Then I can see the lamps. I can see all of this. I perceive this, but how can I say that I see the microphone? No. In order to do this, I have to something should happen in my mind. A certain process of selection should take place. So a range of entities that come around me for me to see the visual art. So to say that this is a lecturing podium, you have to get out of this embrace, of this kind of simple perception. And this is a very simple explanation. We get back to simple perception, and that's what conceptualism does. It brings us back to the simple perception. So it's out of system, a system which is out of system for us to perceive all kinds of object entities. And I guess in this sense, Albert is quite right. Well, if you don't have any other questions, let's thank our lecturer. Thank you, Mikhail.